Okay, thank you very much for being here today. Today we have in our seminar, we have Jesús López Rodríguez. Jesús is a full professor of economics at the University of Da Coruña. He's also a member of the research group, Jean Monnet Research Group on Competition and Regional Development. He was the chair of this research group a couple of years. He has also worked at the Institute for Prospective Technological Studies, Joint Research Center of the European Commission. He has presented a lot of papers in conferences. He has been visiting a scholar in different universities, in Harvard, London School of Economics, Texas, Exeter. He has also had another dimension of his professional career because he has acted as a consultant to several institutions like DG Regio, European Parliament, the Galician Court of Competition, also the Basque Court of Competition. And you will see that, will notice that his research topics are about the geographical economics, regional growth, disparities, EU regional policy, EU political economy, industrial economics, and from recently, he is trying to fit all these topics with fiscal economics and fiscal policy issues. And in fact, this is more or less the topic of the paper he's going to present today in our seminar. So, Jesús, thank you very much for being here with us, virtually here with us. And you have around, as we were talking before, 45 minutes, more or less. Thank you.
Okay, so good morning, everyone. Thank you so much, José María, for your kind introduction. And the first thing I want to say is just, of course, thanks the Universidad Rovira y Virgili for this kind invitation for presenting this paper. And initially, my idea, as José María said, was to giving this seminar on a so to speak, presential format. But due to this kind of complicated issues I had with my staff here in Coruña, I have to cancel the trip, and I decided to give this presentation in this webinar. So sorry for that, and I hope that sooner rather than later, I have the opportunity to be with all of you in person. So having said that, the title of this talk is Fiscal Choices Across Spanish Municipalities, Do Agglomeration Economies Matter? So in a nutshell, the idea is quite simple. It's on the one hand to present a theoretical model which links agglomeration economies and tax setting across jurisdictions, and then try to validate the theoretical predictions of this model using data for the Spanish municipalities. This paper is a joint paper with a couple of colleagues from the University of A Coruña, Bryce Pocinha, and Laura Varela. So let me just start this presentation by motivating the topic with a couple of stylized facts. The first one I want to mention is very well known for all of you, and is based on the idea that economic activities are not randomly distributed across locations. So to speak, activities are concentrated in a small number of locations. And there are many reasons for this type of concentration to occur. Basically, increase on returns to scale, agglomeration forces, transportation costs. And all these reasons are very well combined in the, so to speak, geographical economics models, which are probably the most important models in order to give an economic rationale for the clustering of economic activities across space. A second important fact I want to mention is based on the idea that low corporate taxation might be acting as a booster for the attraction of firms to different places. And probably here the example that comes to mind is the case of Ireland and all of the type of taxation structures that this country unfolded over many years in order to attract many companies to his territory. And from a so to speak, theoretical point of view, tax competition models are models which basically show that in presence of mobile capital, governments are prone to choose low corporate taxes in order to attract these firms to their territories. So to speak, these models predict a kind of race to the bottom in corporate taxation. And here is where geographical economics comes to the fore. And the idea of the geographical economics models, when they are applied to taxation issues, is just to challenge the relevance of these race to the bottom scenarios. And the bottom line is basically playing with the idea of agglomeration forces. So agglomeration forces might be acting as a shield which avoids moving towards these race to the bottom scenarios. I'm going to extend these ideas later on in the talk. So with these ideas, I would like to structure this presentation around these 6 points. First, I'm going to just explain a bit of the literature review in the topic. Then in session 2, I'm going to present the model, the theoretical model, which is going to give us the theoretical prediction, which we will be estimated in the empirical part of the of this of the paper. In the third section, I try to explain the empirical strategy I want to follow in order to validate the theoretical predictions of the model. Section 4 looks at the data. Section 5 looks at the results. And finally, I'm going to wrap up this talk with a set of conclusions. So as far as the literature review concerns, let me just very briefly give you some ideas on the theoretical part of the geographical economics models. So for those who are familiar with these models, probably they are best known as important tools to analyze the spatial distribution of activities across locations. And these models play with three important ingredients from a theoretical standpoint: imperfect competition or monopolistic competition, increasing returns to scale, and transportation costs. And these three ingredients pretty much derive the mechanics of the model through three important effects: the so-called market potential effect, the cost of living effect, and the market crowding effect. So by market potential effect, we refer to how important it is for the firms to be located in places where the market size is important and export from these locations to other locations. So the market potential effect is a kind of agglomeration force. Then we have the cost of living effect, which refers to the impact of location of firms on the local cost of living. And the idea here is basically consumers prefer to be in locations where we have a huge range of firms because they have access to a bigger sample of or a bigger number of goods, and therefore they will have to import for remote locations a narrower set of goods, which will give them this positive element of lower consumer prices. And then we have the third important element in the models, and that is referred to as a market crowding effect, which refers to the idea that firms in perfectly competitive environments, they prefer to be located far away from each other. So they want to move away from competitors. So the idea is that, I mean, the market potential effect and the cost of living effect can be referred to as agglomeration forces, whereas the market crowding effect can be considered as a dispersion force. Other ways of referring to these forces are agglomeration forces are normally referred as to centrifugal forces, and the dispersion forces are referred to as Sorry, agglomeration forces are centripetal forces and dispersion forces are centrifugal forces. So what happens from the empirical point of view? The main theoretical predictions of the geographical economics models are basically four, and after a few seconds I'm going to add any one. So probably the one that receives more attention is the one that links market potential and local factor prices. This is usually referred to as testing the nominal wage equation, and there are many authors that have been have tested this prediction of the geographical economics models. Here I refer probably the most important of them: Redding and Venables, Hanson, Bray Lynch, and I myself with my co-authors have also carried out some work along this line of empirical research. Then a second important prediction from these models that have been subject to empirical testing was the idea of linking human capital accumulation and market potential, basically testing a modified nominal wage equation, where the idea is just to endogenize human capital in these geographical economics models and try to check the idea that market potential is an important factor that drives human capital accumulation. The main reference here is Redding and Schott, and then I myself also did some work along this line, and also Karahas and Bill Gell very recently did an important contribution for the case of regions in Turkey. A third important contribution from an empirical standpoint is the one that links migration flows and this market potential concept, which by the way is an agglomeration force, and the idea is that high market potential induces migration flows. Again, here the main references are Matthew Crosser back in 2004 and Rodrigo Pailacar in 2009. And the fourth line of empirical research links location of firms with market potential, and here again the paper that has received most attention is the one by Head and Mayer back in 2004, but also Crosset and his co-authors have done some work along this empirical line of linking location of and market potential. So if we want to move forward and to analyze tax competition issues, we have to refer basically to a set of authors that have developed these models and linking them to taxation of factors, basically taxation of capital. And these are Richard Baldwin, Marius Brucher, Gianmarco Taviano, Ricard Foslit. These are the main authors that extended the geographical economics models to analyze taxation of factors. And here the idea is that not only capital mobility is going to be the important driver which affects tax competition and therefore tax rates, but agglomeration forces might have important effects on tax rates when jurisdictions engage in tax competition. Which is the bottom line of this idea? The bottom line is quite simple. And the idea is that when we are in a context where agglomeration forces are important, the so to speak footloose production factors, so for instance, business capital, highly skilled human capital, this footloose or so to speak, perfectly mobile production factors might be transformed in quasi-fixed or de facto in immobile production factors. And this means that policymakers, being aware of this this fact, have some room in order to tax agglomerations without putting at risk their tax basis. So this is basically the main idea from an intuitive point of view of how agglomeration forces might be acting as a shield, and we are, in a sense, avoiding this kind of race to the bottom scenarios. So we can add a new line of empirical research trying to link market potential and local taxation, and this is what have been done initially by Charot and Patti back in 2007-2010 for the French municipalities, and I think this was the first paper ever written along these lines of linking geographical economics models and taxation issues. So the idea is that the main insight of these models, when they are used to analyze taxation issues, is that governments are going to be able to extract fiscal rents derived from agglomeration. So which are our goals? So our goals are going to be present and estimate a geographical economics model which assesses the existence of taxable agglomeration rents across Spanish municipalities. And the steps we are going to follow for pursuing these goals are going to be first, present the model, the theoretical model, where the main agglomeration force in this model is market potential, and the model is going to predict that jurisdictions where market potential is high are jurisdictions which set up higher tax rates. And then we are going to estimate this theoretical prediction using Spanish data. The period we are going to choose for our estimation is 2005-2017. And as a preview of our results, I can let you know that we are confirming the theoretical predictions of the model. We also confirm mimicking behavior across Spanish municipalities, the existence of vertical fiscal interactions, and also we are confirming the existence of some sort of opportunistic behavior linked to the electoral cycle. So let me just now talk for a while about the model. The first thing I have to say is that I'm not going to explain, so to speak, in full glory the theoretical model. This could take, for sure, more than the time allotted for this seminar. But I'm going to give you the main building blocks in order to understand the mechanics of the model. So in relation to the setting up of the model, we are going to deal with a 2x2x2x2 model. So this means two regions, north and south, two factors of production, capital and labor, two sectors, the traditional sector, agricultural sector, the manufacturing sector, and two governments, north and south. And the key elements of the model are basically, on the one hand, the shares of capital and labor which belongs to each region, and in particular to the region north. This share of capital and labor is going to be denoted by sigma, and therefore sigma times L, or likewise 1 minus sigma times L, are the workers residing in regions north and south respectively. We are going to assume that region north is larger than region south, so this means that sigma, this parameter, is greater than 1/2. And then another important feature is that the share of the world capital employed in the north region is not the same as the share of capital with which the region north is endowed. So taking into account that capital flies across locations, of course, the share of capital with which region north is endowed is not the same as the share of capital that is going to be employed in the region north. So gamma is going to capture the share of capital employed in region north, which can be, if we take into account corner solutions, can be between 0 and 1. And then we have the assumptions regarding to international mobility. Basically, we are assuming that capital is mobile, whereas labor is immobile across locations. And then other important building blocks of the model, of course, are the utility function which captures the consumer's preferences, the set of technologies under which this sector, the traditional sector and the manufacturing sector operates, and then the assumptions that I just mentioned regarding to international mobility. So solving the model, we're going to solve the model, so to speak, for the free market outcome, and then we're going to introduce governments and solve the task competition game. So when we solve these models, I mean, as when we solve most of, so to speak, general equilibrium models, we have to, on the one hand, we have to solve for the utility and maximization of workers given the budget constraints. So we are able to get the demand functions. We are solving the optimization problem of firms in order to get the equilibrium prices and, in this case, the equilibrium rental rate of capital. And just to close the model, we have to impose this assumption regarding to the so to speak, the market clearing conditions, and here the most important condition is the one referring to the capital, so to speak, the market clearing condition for capital. And then when we combine this equilibrium rental rate of capital with the market clearing condition for in the capital market, so for capital, with the arbitrage condition, and we're going to be able to pin down the location of capital, in this case the location of capital, the location of manufacturing companies in the north region. This guy over here, since I mean it's an important condition in order to pin down the location of capital in the regions, this guy over here refers to the rental rate, the equilibrium rental rate of capital in the north region, which, as you see, is a function of the number of firms located in the south region. And the, another important element to pin down the location of capital is the market clearing condition for capital. Remember that I said that gamma is the share of capital employed in the north region. So gamma times K is going to be the total supply of capital in the north region. And in the model, we do some sort of normalization. So one is that each firm needs one unit of capital, and therefore the number of firms in the north region, or the total demand of capital in the north region, is going to be the number of N times F. So this is the total demand of capital in equilibrium, should be equal to the total supply of capital, which is gamma K. So this is what happens in the north region, the market clearing condition for capital in the north region, and this isomorphic expression is the market clearing condition for capital in the south region. And what is the arbitrage condition? The arbitrage condition basically tells you that the capital is going to flow between regions until the rental rates of capital are equal across locations. So the rental rate of capital in the north region, for the capital to stop flowing across locations, must be equal to the rental rate of capital in the south region. So these rental rates as a function are a function of gamma, and when you solve this for gamma, gives you this expression, which is the allocation of capital in the north region. You see that this guy over here tells you that when sigma, which is the endowment in the north region, is equal to 1/2, so it means that, I mean, regions are similar in size, the allocation of capital is going to be 50% in the north and 50% in the south. And the idea is that, I mean, we are initially assuming that regions are asymmetric in terms of endowment, so sigma is greater than 1/2, and therefore we reach the conclusion that the allocation of capital to the north region is going to be greater than 1/2. This is the, so to speak, the whole market effect. Then what happens when we move forward and we try to solve for the task competitive again? So this means that now we are going to incorporate governments in this game. So governments create distortions by imposing taxes on capital. So the, now the assumptions that region choices regarding to taxes levy on capital going to be made by two regional planners, basically governments. Each planner maximizes the welfare of its citizens, and they going to levy taxes on capital. And therefore, we have to solve for this tax competition game, which is going to be structured in a kind of two-stage process. So in the first stage, governments are going to choose simultaneously their regional welfare maximizing tax rates. And then in a second stage of the game, firms and consumers make their choices conditioned on the tax rates chosen by the by governments. So as you know, these tax competition games are solved by backward induction. So first we solve for the firms and consumers, and then we solve the first stage of the game. So when we are solving this, the second stage of the game, we have to bear in mind that now the arbitrage condition is gonna change. And the new arbitrage condition basically tells us that now the net rental rates of capital, so the rental rate of capital minus the taxes on capital in the north, in equilibrium must be equal to the rental rate of capital in the south minus the taxes on capital in the south. So this is the difference we have with the free market outcome, basically the change in the arbitrage condition in order to get the new equilibria regarding to the allocation of capital between north and south. So you see that now you have that this is the new expression for the allocation of capital, which is going to be a function of the taxes levy on capital in north and south. And the thing that we add to the previous expression is the this part of the expression, which is now in red. So you see again that here, if the taxes in the north are equal to the taxes in the south, basically we get the same solution. But when the government in the north imposes higher taxes than the government in the south, of course this impact the allocation of capital in the north region. Basically, we reach a result which lowers the initial allocation of capital in when we don't have governments levying taxes on capital. So then we have to solve for the first stage of the game. So the idea here is to get the reaction functions for governments in the north and in the south, and maximize this welfare function. So this is the traditional standard welfare function, where we incorporate the surplus of consumers, the total wages in the north region, the total capital rewards in the north region, and we have to discount this element, which basically refer that the capital reward in the north region is basically this. Let me just say that again. You know that I mean the capital employed in the north region is going to be gamma. The capital endowed in the world region is going to be sigma. So since workers are immobile and they are the owners of capital, we have to discount this factor gamma minus sigma in order to factor in this element in the welfare function. And this is the restriction. So when you solve this game, you basically get a solution for the tax rate gap between north and south. And this tax rate gap is given by this guy over here, that this guy over here is going to be greater than zero when regions are asymmetric. So for initially asymmetric regions, you see that the tax rates in the north are greater than the tax rates in the south. Or so to speak, when we have differences in size across locations, those locations with have a higher endowments are going to be locations with which levy a higher taxes on capital compared with regions with which are smaller in size. So this is basically the theoretical prediction of the model, and what we want to do is just to bring this theoretical prediction to the data. So how we are going to proceed in order to validate the theoretical prediction? We are going to build up different models from empirical standpoint. So the first model we want to test is this baseline model, which regresses taxes. In this case, it's going to be local municipal tax rate, or the, so to speak, impuesto a actividades económicas, against market potential or this agglomeration force. And we're going to also control for horizontal tax interactions through this term over here. This term over here, basically, I'm going to explain it in more detail later on, but basically it's telling you which jurisdictions we are considering that are neighbor of jurisdiction I. So there are different ways of analyzing this neighborhood criteria. I'm going to give you more details in a few seconds. So we are also incorporating municipal fixed effects. So this is the baseline estimation. Then, of course, we are going to expand or extend this baseline estimation, trying to control for the fact that jurisdiction may act differently if we take into account the proximity of elections. So in order to control for the proximity of elections, we are going to incorporate dummies to our baseline estimation, basically these three dummies, which takes values 1 and 0, depending on if we are in the year previous to the elections are held, the year elections are held, or 1 year after the elections are held. And then finally, we are going to incorporate another, so to speak, government tier based on the fact that the local municipal business tax rate is set not only at the municipal level, but it also set at provincial level. So we want to check to which extent there are some sort of these different taxes set by provincial provinces and municipalities are strategic or are substitutes. So we do that by controlling for this new element in our regulation. So we are controlling for vertical fiscal interactions. So let me just explain how we, or which kind of data we are going to use for our estimation. First, we are going to use almost all municipalities, all Spanish municipalities. We have 8,000 plus municipalities, but our sample is going to be restricted to 7,000 plus municipalities, because we are going to exclude from our analysis the municipalities which belong to the Canary Islands and Baleares. We are going to also exclude the municipalities that belong to the autonomous provinces of Ceuta and Melilla, and also the municipalities that belong to Basque Country and Navarra. The time frame is 2005-2017, and just giving you a bit more information about how we are going to proceed the different variables we are going to use in our regression analysis. With respect to tax rates, in this presentation I'm going to focus mainly on the, so to speak, impuesto de actividades económicas. This is the main fiscal burden borne by businesses at local level. Then we have another process, but I mean, I'm not going to use in this. I have regressions for this alternative process, which is just compute the share of municipal revenues over municipal gross income, which is an approximation to fiscal burden, but I think I don't bring along with me in these slides the set of estimations for this second process. Then market potential, which is the the central variable in our analysis. So this market potential is a kind of variable that has been widely used in the regional economics literature. Actually, this expression here is, so to speak, called Harris market potential. And in a sense, it's a weighted average of the volume of economic activity in the surrounding location. So if you want to compute the market potential at the location I, you have to take into account the volume of economic activities in location surrounding location I, discounted by the distance between I and the remaining J locations. This market potential can be broken down in two different components, the, so to speak, domestic market potential and foreign market potential. So domestic market potential is the market potential created by the own region, and foreign market potential is the market potential created by the remaining regions. Now, there is how we proxy this, the numerator of this expression. So the numerator can be proxy in many different ways. We can use population of each municipality. We can use municipal gross income, municipal disposable income. We're going to use these different alternatives in a kind of giving robustness to our results. So when we are using proxy 2 and 3, municipal gross income and municipal disposable income, we have to impute these incomes because we don't have data for gross income and disposable income at municipal level for municipalities with less than 1,000 inhabitants. Then another important issue here is how we measure these distances across locations. Probably the best way of or the idea that comes to mind is that, okay, we're going to use distances measured in kilometers across locations, and this is the one of our process, just taking into account the distances between municipalities, so the centroid of each municipality. But also we're going to use an alternative proxy for intermunicipal distance, which is to compute travel times across locations. So probably the idea of the difference between intermunicipal distance measuring kilometers and measuring minutes of travel time across locations is that when we are using minutes, we are just controlling for the quality of the infrastructure. So to speak, I mean, when you have to travel across, so if the distance between I and J is 100 kilometers, it's not the same. I mean, if this 100 kilometers are in a flat surface or in a rugged surface. So the distance is the same, but I mean the time measured in minutes is going to be different. So a way of controlling for the quality of infrastructure is by computing travel times across municipalities. And then we have the intra-municipal distance, and this intra-municipal distance is standard to model it in the geographical economics literature as a function of the area of the municipality. So the idea is that when we are comparing municipalities which differ in size, so the bigger the size, the greater should be the intermunicipal distance. So this is the kind of expression we are using for computing this intermunicipal distance. And we are considering that each municipality have a kind of circle type of shape. So if you remember, the area of a circle is P times R squared. So if you substitute in this expression area for P times R squared, you end up saying that the intermunicipal distance is proportional to the radius of a circle which surfaces the area of the municipality. And then this lambda means that we are going to scale this intra-municipal distance using these scaling factors, 1/3, 1/2, and 2/3. So this is one way. Another way is just to compute again these intermunicipal distances using travel times. And then for this approximation, we have to compute average speeds across municipalities, and we are ranging these average speeds based on the fact that municipalities can be urban, intermediate, and rural, and therefore we consider different speeds: 20 kilometers when municipalities are urban, 30 kilometers when they are intermediate, and 50 kilometers when they are rural. And this is the way of transforming distance in kilometers in distance in travel times, which is quite straightforward. And then we have another important element, which is the weighting matrix. The weighting matrix tells you who is neighbor of whom. So this is an important element in the spatial econometrics literature. A way of saying, an alternative way of saying that this weighting matrix is controlling for the existence or the presence of horizontal tax interactions across municipalities. We have chosen as the first criteria the 5 nearest neighbors, but we have also 10 nearest neighbors, and we also did several robustness tests using alternative weighting matrices. One alternative weighting matrix is just to compute the inverse of the distance across municipalities, also with different weighting schemes. Alpha equals to 1 means that, I mean, we assume a linear decay function. When alpha is equal to 2, we assume a faster decay function, so the interaction across municipalities fades much faster. So this is the what we are capturing with this weighting matrix when alpha is equal to 2. And then we have another proxy for this weighting matrix, which is just adding to the previous one, multiplying the previous one by the population. The idea is that we are going to give more weight to those municipalities that, having the same distance, are bigger in terms of population. And then just moving to the results. So this is the municipal structure of Spain. We are here just giving this or showing this map and ranging municipalities according to population tranches. Then you have here this table, which basically is to emphasize that the main tax we are going to focus on is the business tax, which on the pool of direct taxes represents 7.5% of the income that municipalities get through direct taxation. Here you have a plotting of the business tax rate across Spanish municipalities, but probably let me just jump to this graph for the sake of brevity. And in this graph, I'm just linking market potential across municipalities with business tax rate, and roughly you see that municipalities with high market potential are, on average, municipalities that set higher business tax rates. So this is the first visual approach to the link between market potential and business tax rate. And now let's see what happens when we move to our econometric results. So let me just first analyze the results in our baseline model. Remember that the baseline model was a model in which we have two important variables: market potential, or the variable that measures agglomeration force. This is our central variable, and the variable that is controlling for horizontal tax interactions through the weighting matrix. So here I'm going to focus in columns 1 and 2. So we are just regressing local business tax rate against horizontal tax interactions. and against agglomeration forces proxy by market potential. And here market potential is measured using distances in travel times, and this is scaling lambda equals to 1/3 for the intra-municipal distances, and the proxy for the numerator is population. So you see that the core result is that the coefficient of market potential. So you see that the coefficient of market potential is positive and is statistically significant, but also we have a positive and statistical significant coefficient for the parameter of the weighting matrix, this raw parameter. So here the idea is that the theoretical predictions of the model are validated with data for the Spanish municipalities. The difference between columns 1 and 2 is that in column 1, we are using as a weighting matrix the 5 nearest neighbors, and in column 2, as a robustness, I'm using the alternative definition of the weighting matrix, where I use as a neighborhood criteria the inverse of the distance between municipality I and remaining municipalities, and using this alpha equals to 2, which means that the interaction across municipalities decays with the square of the distance. Then, moving to the extended estimation, we have here, like, I mean, 8 different sets of econometric results. So let me just group them in bundles. So the first bundle probably is columns 1, 2, and 3. In this 1, 2, and 3, I'm just checking for using alternative measures of market potential, and no matter which definition of agglomeration economies, I'm using the coefficient estimate for market potential is positive and is statistically significant. So here I'm using travel times, population, lambda equal to 2/3. Here in column 2, I'm using travel times as a proxy for the numerator, municipal income, and lambda equal to 1/3. And here I'm breaking down the market potential into its domestic component and foreign component. And I also see that the coefficients associated to these two components of total market potential are positive and are statistically significant. Columns 4 and 5, we are using different weighting schemes for our neighborhood criteria. Here, in column 4, I'm using the inverse of the distance, the distance decay is to the power 2, so it's the square of the distance, and here I'm using the inverse of the distance weighted by population. So again, you see that the coefficient associated to market potential is positive and statistically significant. Columns 6 and 7, I'm controlling for the electoral cycle, where you see that the dummy for the year's elections are held is negative, and this basically means that governments have some sort of opportunistic behavior when the elections are held, probably in order to profit for capturing a higher number of votes. And then in column 8, I'm extending the estimation using the idea that we have two levels of government, municipal plus provincial, and we are controlling for this the existence of vertical fiscal interaction. In this case, we see that when the province set up a higher business tax rate, this leads to a lower tax rate at municipal level. So in a sense, we are also confirming the existence of vertical fiscal interactions, and in this case, these tax rates act as substitutes. So just to end up this presentation. The idea is that first we have very few contributions in this literature which links geographical economics models with tax setting. So far, I mean, the most important one is the paper written by Charlotte and Patty in 2007. So we want to extend this literature using data for the Spanish municipalities, first by describing a model which tries to link these two important elements, agglomeration economies and tax setting functions. And we estimate this the tax setting, which is derived from the model, using data for the Spanish municipalities. The results, as I just mentioned, are basically, or we can say that we have four types of results. First, and the most important one, is that we are confirming the predictions of the model. The second important result, which is in line with so to speak, the standard tax competition models, is that we also have this mimicking behavior across municipalities. So if neighboring municipalities set up higher tax rates, the municipality in question is going to set up higher tax rates, and vice versa. We also confirm the existence of opportunistic behavior in relation to the electoral cycle. And finally, we are also confirming vertical fiscal interactions, because in our case, the tax base of the EI, of the Impost of Economics, is shared between provinces and municipalities. And just as a way forward in this line of research, we want, on the one hand, to disentangle these tax setting effects with an alternative classification of territories or municipalities. Here, basically, we refer to the use of a classification based on local labor markets, which was or which is a matter of research for Rafa Boyce and Sforzi. They did extensive work for Italy and also for Spain. So we want to use this classification and redo our estimations just to check, I mean, what happens in with this alternative definition. We have also more ideas in our agenda. And now I think is okay. I'm just about to finish. It's two past two. I think I square with the time allotted for this presentation. So I'm gonna stop here and just I'm gonna be ready for your comments, questions. If you have some sort of questions or that. So thank you so much for giving me this this time for presenting this new research. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, anybody has a question regarding the talk of Jesus? Yes, Jose Maria.
Okay, thank you very much for this presentation. I think it's a nice combination of theoretical and applied work. Just a couple of comments about this idea about relationship between agglomeration economics and taxation. There is another argument, which is that because you said whether low taxation is attracting firms, you may also say that that if you are lowering your taxation levels, then you are lowering the quality of your local services. So then at the end, you are not longer attracting firms, but you are repelling them because the places become less attractive if the low taxation may be transformed into lower quality of public services in a given area. But apart from that, I think it's a very nice work. My only concern is about, well, I have several concerns, but But my main concern is about whether the proxy you are following, which is mainly the business tax, the IAE, it really it's an appropriate tool, because whether really IAE differs at local level in a sufficient way in order to motivate these decisions taken by firms, because I guess that there are mainly small variations at a local level across different municipalities.
Okay, so thank you so much, José María, for your comments and concerns. So regarding the first comment, if it is true what you have just mentioned, you are lowering taxation, of course. I mean, the risk of lowering your taxation is that you have you cannot provide as much as public goods as if you have a higher level of taxation and a higher level of revenues. This is true, and probably this is the kind of issue we want to explore further on along this line of research, because what we are seeing in a kind of exploratory analysis is that we have some sort of non-linearities when you are combining agglomeration and taxation, so to speak. When you are analyzing regions or municipalities which have a low levels of agglomeration, you have the incentives of increasing your you have the incentives of decreasing your tax rate. Why? You have the incentives of decreasing your tax rate because you want to attract, to pull more firms towards your jurisdiction. But of course, I mean, the caveat of that is that you are not going to be able to offer as many public goods as regions where agglomeration economies are stronger. So this is an important caveat. So you have this kind of tension between, on the one hand, lowering your taxes, which is a kind of incentive for firms to come into your territory, but on the other hand, you have this, so to speak, centrifugal force that says, okay, since I'm not raising enough revenues, I'm not going to be able to have a good quality of infrastructure, roads, and so on and so forth. So this is an issue that, I mean, we want to explore in more detail, just disaggregating regions according to different thresholds of agglomeration. And our first idea is that we have this sort of non-linearities. So for low agglomeration municipalities, the level of taxation decreasing, and for high agglomeration regions, I mean, the main idea we are getting is the one that I presented here. The taxes increase because, yeah, you have this because the agglomeration forces are important for many companies or many businesses to thrive when these businesses are faced to, so to speak, increase on returns to scale. Then the second important issue you just raised, and it is a very important one, is the one related to the proxy we are using.
Jesus, please, sorry to interrupt. Please, yes. Try to be more brief in discussion. Then you may continue the discussion with José María later.
Right. Okay. So thank you so much, Antonio. So the second issue is the one related to the proxy for our main variable, the business tax rate. In fact, it is true. This variable Okay, this variable, first of all, is important that the municipalities have power in order to modify the municipality business tax rate. It doesn't vary that much. You know that it varies with population. The minimum is set almost equal to every municipality, but then according to the threshold of population, you have different limits you can impose on this level. You have variability, not as much as you would like for running the exercise, but yeah, this is a caveat. We can explore alternative proxies, but the one that is more linked to the model in a kind of a structural fashion is this one. But thank you for the comment.
Okay, Jesus, thank you very much for your, for the seminar and for answering so well the comments of Jose Maria. Anybody would like to make a last comment very briefly? So, well, if nobody will, so, oh, wait, I think there is somebody. Oscar Martinez. Oscar, feel free to.
Do you hear me? Sorry?
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Jesus, for your presentation. I have only one question. If I wonder if you don't have problem with the possible endogeneity of your main explanatory variable, this that measure the activity of the municipality. You don't have a problem of on.
Yes. I got
Jesus,
this one. Yeah.
Please answer very briefly because we are already very much out of time.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. This the endogeneity issue is a problem, and in our estimations we are in the next set of estimations we are trying to deal with this issue. And one way is either use IV estimation just to find the nice instruments for market potential, and another, since we have a panel, we have another alternative way is that use historical values for market potential. So when we are lagging market potential, instead of doing this kind of contemporaneous type of regression, we hope that we be able to handle in a good way this endogeneity, IV or historical values for market potential.
Thank you very much, Jesus.
Thank you very much, Jesus, and thank you very much all of you that have participated. Jesus, so well, we'll keep in contact, and I was going about to say nice return home, but well, you're already at home, no? So okay, so we'll finish the seminar here, and thank you, Jesus, thank you for all that have attended. Okay.
Okay. So. Thank you.
Have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much for having me. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. See you.
See you.
Hasta la próxima, Jesús.